That's right, folks. We are back. Midway Radio is back. And I'm your boy, Carlos Gomez. And as always, we're going to go around and see who's in the chat room. We got Ryan Brockmeyer.
Good evening, everybody.
We got Barb Kalicki.
Hello.
We got the one, the only DJ Risky Business.
What's up?
Straight out the streets, y'all. This week, we're talking to that one dude that everybody knows and loves. He came in here. He was all, he got all chatty and shit. He got to going. And we're like, yo, save it for the show, son. That, my friends, we're talking to Andre Vasquez, a.k.a. Prime. Welcome to the show, Prime.
Hey, how's it going? How's it going? What's going on, everybody?
Good. Good to have you, kid.
Good to be here, man. It's pretty dope. Thank y'all for that.
Thanks. Thanks for taking the time, you know, from your PBS and WDTW,
taking some time on there.
Take some time to, you know.
It's political. Yeah,
I appreciate that.
The political schedule. I'm
here waiting. He called the timeout on Fight the Power.
Nah, man. Like I said, it's cool. Like I've been wanting to do it just because it's pretty dope to be able to talk about so much. You know what I'm saying? Like, so thank y'all.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Of course. Yeah. And as always, we're going to check in with the dude with all the spreadsheets. See what we got going on this week. Mr. Spreadsheet.
I take it you're talking about me because I know it ain't risky.
We know it ain't risky.
Nope. You kidding me? I get emails ever. Like, join this spreadsheet.
If you are in the Chicagoland area, do not send this kid a text message. Not a spreadsheet, not a text message, no smoke signals. If you want to talk to Risky, you got to lay down like a trail of food. Be like, come and talk to me because we got something. That's the only way to.
Yep. Pequods. Meet me at Pequods. All right.
Put out a line of Pequods.
Or Portillo's, you know. He likes Portillo's.
Well, yeah.
I do like Portillo's.
This is true, too.
Chopped salad is the best.
Is that your favorite thing to get at Portillo's is the chopped salad?
Yes.
Have you ever had the chicken pecan salad?
No.
Oh, just go get that luscious bowl of diabetes and call it a day. Listen, son, I don't even know if it's legal to call that mess a salad, dude. They just kind of put like some green food coloring on it. It is so good. It's just a bowl of candy. You can hand that out at Halloween.
Yeah, but then you're eating nuts in a salad, and that's just wrong.
Well, there's a joke somewhere.
There's a lot of pauses that just happened right there. Ryan, what's in the news this week?
The biggest thing.
Ryan, what's tossed your salad?
it's going to be one of those episodes. I want to remind everybody, and we'll, you know, people probably have seen it on social media, but tomorrow night, Midway is going to be part of an event at the Chicago History Museum. It's an event called Chicago Voices, put on by Lyric Opera, and this particular one is on hip-hop and how the city inspires the sound. And we are going to be there with the Center for Black Music Research and Columbia College. And we're going to be showing off some of the artifacts and stuff that we started to collect for the project. So people come by and check that stuff out starting at 6:00. And Risky and Sean Dell will be there. We'll be playing some music, possibly some videos. We're trying to figure out the AV setup for it. And then so that goes from 6 to 7. And then starting at 7:00, there's going to be a panel discussion. And it's going to be moderated by Ayanna Contreras from Vocals Reclaim Soul show. And the panelists include Amina from Urbanized Music, and Add Two, young up-and-coming producer Odd Couple, and Andrew Barber from Fake Shore Drive. And it's $10 to get into the event. It's $5 if you're a member. So, yeah, for more information, go to chicagohistory.org and you can click on the events page and see what that's about. But that's tomorrow night, so we're looking forward to that. And then some people may have seen that we're starting to get the vignettes out again. So it's been a while. We're working on some other things and stuff. So, so we're going to have a lot of
Who came out this week? Who came out this week?
Today was Bamski.
Yeah.
So tell us
about Bamski for those of us who maybe or maybe haven't heard of him. By the way, we follow each other on Twitter, so we're tight. But for those folks, I was trying to set up the stage. But why is Bamski in the interview process?
Yeah, Hall of Fame. Is that what you're saying?
Risky, answer that real quick while I go. Spoiler.
Absolutely no. Bamski is an MC from the South Side, who a lot of people. He is one of these guys who was super ill, and a lot of things kind of followed the Chicago story. He was really close as far as like he didn't have a whole lot of recorded material, but everywhere you went, you heard about Bamski. You saw him at a show.
I actually saw him at one of the first shows I was at.
He was mind-blowing. Bamski is an insane MC. He was connected to a lot of different people. And his story, his personal story about how he went through, how he came through the industry, how he came to the industry and through the industry is really moving. And it was one of my favorite interviews we did. And one of his records is a song called Candy Store, which is considered by a lot of people to be a Chicago classic on wax. It was produced by Doug Infinite and came through All Natural Records, right? Was it on the Family Tree album?
Yeah. It was like the EP, wasn't it? Not the full album.
No, it was on the record, the 12-inch EP, the vinyl EP of Family Tree. He was extended All Natural Family, and everywhere he showed up, when he showed up on people's guest verses or on compilations, one of my all-time favorite records is a record to do with Profound M Flu from that was Copper Pot's Chapter 7 album. He's sick. He's dope. I think Prime would agree. Prime knows dope MCs.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, like when you really think about, like, there's so many ill Chicago MCs, and like Rissy was saying, I think some of it's timing, right? Like some dudes are around when everyone's recording everything, and some of us are from different eras. Like if you think about how much everybody records stuff now, and like all the heads that were doing stuff back then, like if that was like, if there's a time machine, it'd be pretty sick.
Yeah.
So last week, some of the new vignettes that we put out was Toby Nibble from All Natural.
That's a great one.
We got Mary Datcher. We got Andy C. Today was Bamski, and we're gonna have a couple more this week. We're gonna try to put out three a week. Is the plan? So stay tuned every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday.
On average.
Yep.
On average.
Yep.
Well, actually, here, let's do this. Because we talked about it a little bit on the show last week, where people just see a documentary and they're like, ah, dope, this is cool. They don't understand how much time or effort goes into it. For something like a vignette that is just basically just a little snippet, a little sneak peek behind the curtain, explain briefly what it takes to just get the footage and then how long it takes to get it from when you're looking to your, it's all cut up and then
the
released.
Whole process.
Yeah. So, the vignettes are something where, you know, they serve a couple purposes. We want to make sure that everybody gets a voice out there that we've interviewed, because as we said multiple times, not everybody that we talk to is going to be able to make it into that 2-hour block of the film. We're going to do what we can to get as many people in as we can. But at the very least, everybody's going to be up and part of the project from having, you know, being part of their own video, being a part of some other videos and stuff like that. Now, the stuff with the vignettes, the stuff that people say in them may or may not make it into the film, because we pick some random stories. We pick something that's funny that might not have anything to do with anything. We pick stuff that is maybe very profound that's most like, man, that's something that's going to make it into the trailer. So it's very arbitrary. That being said, we have to review all the notes that we take when we're interviewing people and kind of figure out what we want to do. So it's basically go back and kind of rewatching the interviews and finding a little interesting minute, 2-minute clip, something like that we want to do. From there, it goes through the editing process. And of course, there's a couple cameras that we use. It's got to go through all the audio process and all the
yeah, we graphics. It literally has to go through. Ryan has to get it. He has to cut the piece out. After he finds it, however many hours or time it takes to find it, he has to cut it out. Then he has to take the different camera angles, put it together, sync it. Then we have to send the audio to our audio department, which is another completely another person that's handling it. Our guy Andy right now is handling that, and he takes it and he's cleaning everything up, and then he sends it back to Ryan. Ryan syncs it up, makes sure everything's good, then we put it out. And the thing with, like you said, Ryan, one of the key things about the vignettes is we're trying to find something. We don't want to give everything away in the film, or in a vignette. So we're trying to find things that are really good and interesting, but probably won't be something we would use in the film, but still has a good impact.
Yeah, for sure. So, you know, that's kind of the basic process behind that. But on top of all that, you know, what we hope that everybody realizes is that that's just one small aspect of the overall project. So there's tons of stuff that's always being worked on by a small team of, you know, six or seven people. And so sometimes some things have to get neglected or pushed back and this and that. Same way with interviews. We can't interview every day. We do what we can. So we try to spread ourselves out in the most responsible way possible. That's in a nutshell, Carlos.
So roughly, it's safe to say it could take anywhere from a couple hours to about 5 or 6 hours, depending.
It's a good 4 to 5 hours worth of man time going into it, like man
right.
hour.
So imagine what you do when you go into work. Imagine 4 hours, that's half your day, but you get paid for it. All of this is work that's getting put into it just for pure love of the project.
Mm-hmm.
Pure love.
Yeah,
that's basically, I just wanted to give a little bit of clarity to, you know, because people will be like, oh, this is only like 2 minutes long. Well, yeah, but it takes four hours to get it out. And, you know, it's just, it's a lot behind this. And it's
multiply a lot of people that times 71, 72 vignettes.
It's a lot of people that go behind doing something. And I hate to say it this way, but something as simple as a vignette, which is 2 minutes long, the same person, you have the same collection of camera footage. Putting it together, it takes a handful of people to just get this out the door.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if we just went by the average that we just talked about in the total time from that it takes to review an interview, to pick out something, to edit it, to get a rough cut done, to get the audio and graphics done, to sync up and do the final cut release, and then upload that to YouTube. If we average that out to like 4 hours per vignette, we've done, 74 vignettes? You know, that comes to about 300 hours that we spent just putting on the vignettes that we have out. So, it's a process, you know, and it's funny because we get a lot of people that'll comment and think that like that's the project is just putting out little clips, and it's like, no, that's just to keep the momentum going. That's to show that that's this thing is appetizer. Still being worked on. That's just the appetizer.
Nah.
Of course. So, and we've got other ideas for other videos and other things that we're trying to work on. It just takes time.
Well, yeah. I think you should
just like, the appetizer. We still got the full like, chicken pecan salad coming.
What's up, Brian?
Oh no, I was saying like that actually says a lot about the project that people are that blown away by the vignettes. They think that's the project, right? The quality, even for something that you're doing,
right?
Like it's not like straight up the like the Tone B vignette is like my favorite. And like seriously, like to know that story and had no idea about that, like I was riveted by. Yeah, it was like a minute or two. So
yeah, it's dope,
and he was
right?
having such a good time telling that story.
Oh, you can tell.
And you know Tone B. If you know Tone B, what's special about that vignette is Tone is a reserved guy, and unless you like really know him, unless you're like someone that hangs out with them, you probably would never know that because that's not something he would ever. Like offer up at like hanging out, you know, you could know Tone B for 5 years if you're an acquaintance with them and never ever have any idea that ever took place. I mean, Tone's just so reserved, you would never know that he worked at 106, that he did this and that. You'd never know that he's Tone B Nimble half the time. And to be able to get that, and then when he told it, I actually smile when I see that because I love to see how excited he got. It was just like seeing him get out of his shell, because if you know Tone, he doesn't get out of his shell that much. So it was dope. I was like, wow, this is great. This is good. He really, yeah, he got into it.
Opened up.
No, that was exactly it. It's like exactly what you just said. Like I've known him for a while, and I'd never seen like there was like this joy in telling the story that was super visible. That was like it was really cool to watch. Like,
yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, that's part of going with it, and you know, and part of the quality and part of the stuff that we're bringing to the film. We got, you know, we've been teasing for a few weeks now that we're working on a lot of other things that are, you know, that we're going to be announcing soon. I don't want to make the full announcement tonight. I'll do a quick teaser, and I'll just say that we're working on something with a very prominent technology company that we should be able to announce. Hopefully next week. We're ironing out a few of the details, but it's coming, and we're gonna have a series of events that's gonna start in late February. We're gonna have three of them to start off with. So just keep in mind for that. We'll I think people will be really excited about that.
Yeah, you'll be able to definitely like Google it and find out.
Really? Yeah,
that's risky trying to name drop. Yeah, should we see that?
Risky can't let anybody get away with nothing, boy.
I mean, I'm gonna go to the kitchen. That's exactly how people will find out, right?
Risky, yep.
Risky's like, I'm gonna go to the kitchen, guys, and get me an apple. All right, I'm out.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyway.
So let's go to our guest.
I yeah, have so most many ones in my.
So Prime. Have you officially retired the Prime name, or is there still a little music left in the tank?
So, that's actually a really good question. I wouldn't say retired. I don't think it kind of works. Like, I don't think it works like that. I've never had anybody say they retire and actually like pans out. I'd say I'm focused on some things right now, but I've got music that hasn't been released, and I don't know. I'm still up in the air as to whether it will or won't, but I've got, I think about an EP or album done that I've just kind of been sitting on. So, but hey, I've been doing.
What
some
makes an artist? What makes an artist work on a project and then just be like, okay. And it's just.
So yeah, no, that's a good question. Like, I typically aren't like that. Like, I'm somebody who likes putting stuff out, but I think part of it is like now having kids and getting married and like a lot of things that I've been working on, like all the community organizing and everything, have kind of taken such a focus that I almost feel like if I were to, I might kind of reframe certain things that I'm working on. So a lot of it is that, and a lot of it is like. I mean, you guys kind of know, right? Like you work on something and you're crafting it and you're investing like time and your vision behind it. And if it's not right, you're going to still hold on to it because there's a certain way you want to put it out.
Well, I think it's very similar.
A little bit of everything goes into that.
Yeah, I think it's similar to like an illustrator or somebody who draws. You know, you constantly have like a sketchbook with you. You're constantly drawing and sketching and refining your ideas. And then sometimes there's that idea that you're like, oh, I'm going to complete this a little bit further. And I'm going to, you know, maybe add some color or ink it or do something. I think that, you know, that's the same thing with like musicians. You may, or rappers especially, you know, you're constantly writing and constantly thinking of concepts and stuff. And it's, you know, kind of what you... Yeah. End up, you know, exploring more.
It's definitely like, you know, I think people, creative people in general, right? And it's something you've got to be super people who like will baby something to death and like never release it because you're like, man, I need to fix this or tweak that. And then you've got other people who are like, let's just put it out. So I think sometimes I've tried both. And I have to consciously tell myself sometimes that like, okay, you need to let this one go and like go to the next project because people will watch the evolution and the growth of what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it's a tough thing to balance. Like you really do have to have like those conversations with yourself about what you want to do next. So I'm always doing that. But yeah, like I've got currently the one I have done has Droog is on it. Tragedy Gaddafi's on it. Ill Bill. And I think Little Vic was working on it. So I've like literally got stuff and I've got the cameos and all that, but
nice.
I don't know what I would do with it eventually. So.
Well, I think at some point it needs to see the light of day or at least make its way over into Risky and I's library of Chicago hip hop.
Yeah.
And by Risky and I, he means all of us.
who's on the production on this?
That's right. So SC did a lot on there. And there was like a lot of, I mean, what's crazy now is that you can get so much from so many people like across the globe, right? That there's mad production. There was stuff where, like I took Skit off of like, was it Daily Operation? Right. And like looped that and kind of did like a whole two verse thing over it.
Oh, dope.
So it was just a lot. It really was out of the stuff that I've done, like just something that I really like love doing. And like, let me pick some stuff that I like and write verses towards it. Like it's pretty interesting.
You did a record a couple years ago with Mass Hysteria, I believe was on it with where you guys sampled, I think, did Custom do the beat or with the Kavinsky track?
No. See, that's the thing too, man. Honestly, when I saw it, I feel so whack because half the time I can't remember some of the production on it or like who did it. But yeah, it was a drive sample, so it was like that Night Call.
Yeah, the Night Call, the Kavinsky. Yeah, yeah.
Sample. Oh my god! Ever since when I saw the movie, I've seen that movie Drive. I saw it at least 4 or 5 times in the theater. That like the second I was able to find that and figure out, I think that's why I don't remember the producer. I sent it to people and I was like, if you can flip this, like I want that, like bad. So. I remember getting that and hitting up.
I feel like
Mike.
Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, it was, man.
I feel like Custom did that beat, or Loose Cannon. No, Loose.
It might have been somebody like. Yeah, it was Cannon. You're right. Loose Cannon did that one.
Okay. But, yeah. I knew it was one of the cats. I knew it was somebody connected to you, Middle Ground.
Like Cannon's always sick because I remember I was in like a big Amy Winehouse phase and like I would give him the records and he would just flip like crazy little cuts off of that. So
he's dope. He's underrated.
Yeah.
You speaking of Drive, have you ever seen the original movie that Drive was completely inspired from? It completely jacked this movie, the original movie.
No, it wasn't.
Pee-wee's Big Adventure. Have you seen it?
I'm going to show you right now.
No.
Hold up. No.
Not that one.
It's a hazard.
With the flag.
Right here. So right here. So this movie right here. If you can see it. James Caan, Thief. Yeah, if you even see, you can see it's like the neon lettering. The lettering's very similar. Tangerine Dream did the soundtrack, so it was an electronic soundtrack. And the movie Thief is super interesting because it's Michael Mann's first, like his second film. It takes place about Chicago jewel thieves. James Caan is a jewel thief.
And it's Chicago?
Oh, and it's one of the best Chicago film movies I ever seen. What's dope about it is, so James Caan, Michael Mann, like a lot of people don't know, he was connected to members in The Outfit. Somehow he grew up with dudes from The Outfit or whatnot. So when James Caan was doing like the scene where he's actually breaking into the safe in this, he actually was taught how to do it, and he's doing it, and he did it right there. Like the whole scene in the beginning where he's breaking in, it's him actually doing it. He said it's his favorite moment in the history of film because he felt like he's graduating like high school or something, right? But right. What happened was, is, and you can look this up like in an old like if you look up old newspaper articles, James Caan got busted by the FBI. So they were listening to members of The Outfit, and he was going to go on a jewel heist with them for like, and the FBI stepped in and was like, bro, you can't do this. We're not going to let you do this. So they came in and just like stepped in and were like, we're not letting you go do this. So yeah, it was that real.
That you were in a movie that's with James Caan. Wow. That was
that.
Dude, what? How was yeah. that?
Oh, this guy. And then
tell us about that. You went from making a record to a movie with James Caan. Wow.
And then listen to this. He one of the actors in the film was at the time when the film came out, was on the FBI's most wanted list because he was a member of The Outfit, and Michael Mann had him in the film as an extra, as one of the goons in the extra.
Is that I'm assuming that's before The Godfather, right?
No, this is after The Godfather. This is like 1980. This came out 80, 81.
Oh, that's yeah. You just put me up on that one. I got to check that one out.
Yeah. Oh, Thief's a classic, dude. Check it out. The soundtrack's amazing too. It's Tangerine Dream. It's amazing. Anyway, dope. Next question.
I don't even remember what the previous question was.
The question was,
don't ask Risky a question.
The question is, where is Risky's mute button?
hold up.
Oh. All right, do you like James Caan as an actor?
Is that the question? Yeah. James
Caan's a beast,
man.
No,
Risky's like, and what's... I've got Thief Part 2.
Risky is the human derail.
Para, what's better, James Caan the actor or Scott Caan the rapper?
Yo, I was because Scott Conn's homies with Alchemist, you gotta give him like Gary him on a curve on that.
I agree. a little bit of a curve.
Yo, isn't it crazy? And I'm sorry if I went on a tangent. Isn't it crazy to watch like Alchemist on like
Pestilicious?
Viceland?
Yeah.
It's like really crazy to watch him like just sitting there like doing random stuff, and I'm like, yo, make some beats, bro. It's crazy.
I was actually tripping because Ryan, you sent me the F That's Delicious where they go to Rico Benny's on 26th Street.
That actually didn't make the I actually watched the episode and that did not make the episode.
Good. Thank God.
It was like an outtake.
I was so upset that was gonna be on TV because I go there and I don't want to deal with lines and tons of people and people discovering Rico Benny's. Just that's stay hilarious. Away from there. Don't ever. Yeah.
Don't
I don't want people to know about
there
it.
Ever. So Risky can be go there anytime.
They've
he
got
wants.
Big rats there.
Not
stay away from there.
Line.
To be fair, though, the bread and steak sandwich from Rico Benny's has been on many a food list, best sandwiches in the country. So.
Yep.
It's already out there. It's not like a secret. So.
Yeah, but when it hits like the hipster TV shows, then everyone flocks to it.
You're gonna get mad.
Would you like to talk more about Vice there, Risky?
I mean,
hey Prime, why don't you tell us? Prime, tell us about the time you met Risky.
Ooh, yeah. Let's hear.
Yo, I'm going to be real, and I thought about this prior to, like, the interview. Like, I am fully aware that there's a good, like, chunk of my 20s and 30s, or like 20s, where I was so wasted that, and I'm just being straight up. That, Risky, you remember the first time we met?
I do.
You enlighten me, and I bet I'll finish it up.
It was at the Bog. Remember the Bog?
The Bog. Oh my God.
Okay, so those that don't know, I'll explain real quick and give a little backstory. For those that don't know, Third Rail, it was Third Rail's parties. He used to throw these parties over on at a rec center by IIT, and it's known as the Bog. And it's at 31st and Federal. And he would throw super, super dope underground hip-hop parties. He would bring in he brought in Necro. He brought in, I can't remember if he brought in, I don't remember if he brought in Defari. He brought in Name. Bunch of dope groups he'd bring in. And he would just have small, and I mean, this was a small underground, like, rec center where these parties would go down. And I was there selling mixtapes, and you bought a mixtape from me.
Do you remember who performed at that one?
No.
Like, do you remember mixtape was any good or not?
yeah, it was the shadiest, I think, you probably bought from me. That Eminem mixtape.
If Eminem was on it, like, I was copping everything. So, like,
that's the one that put Risky on the map, kid.
Oh, yeah, no. That was, like, Eminem was, like, the amount of product and, like, the quality of everything dropped. It was like, oh, he's on it? Done. Oh, it's a mixtape?
Done.
Sure. Sold.
Yeah, cassettes at that too. Yeah, and I don't know. It could have been, it might have been the Necro one. Yeah, Necro one? Where Ill Bill was there just walking around and nobody knew who Ill Bill was because nobody knew Nonfiction yet?
Yeah, like that. I remember because I was in a cypher with Ill Bill, I think the next day, because they were outside of Supreme Records.
Okay. Oh, yeah, Supreme.
And if it wasn't for those events, like that's where I met Breeze Everflowing too. So that kind of led to like, wouldn't have been on the Blaze Battle or the MTV or any of it. So, like, it's really crazy to like, when you mention the Bog, like, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that was, those were great parties, man.
Yeah, and you and I were, like, I mean, obviously, we've done shows together and, like, really worked it. Like, I was super, I mean, thinking about those times, like, I was really, I would say, kind of socially awkward. So, I would only be like, yeah, what's up? I'm like, pound, all right, I'm out, peace. Like, not really talking. I don't know how we actually ended up working together because I'm surprised I got the words out. But I'd be like,
No, I think we ended up like hanging out a few times, but probably like through Necro or something, like because I knew Pugs. So we probably ended up building that way. I can't remember how it continued, but I do remember that you started hanging out with us, but you were a few years younger than us.
Yeah, it was a weird thing for me because, and I think about it now, that like I was like younger than the heads that were out doing things, but older than like the next generation of like,
sure, yeah, yeah, yep.
Oops.
So you were just like under us though. Like when we were going into the clubs, but here's the thing about Prime. We would go into the clubs and Prime couldn't get in a lot of times. You came with me to certain ones and I was able to get you in. But like Double Door, like Blue Groove, you couldn't get in. So you would like wait right outside. And this dude, we'd come out 2 hours later, and Prime was still out there. He was battling everybody that stepped outside. That's how hungry this kid was. Is he go, I'm going to chill right here. And then anytime someone would come out the door, he'd be like, yo.
Yes. Yeah, no, I was that. And I was like, I could probably say with confidence, the record crate carryingest rapper you guys know. Like, I remember getting every single place. Carrying like PNS's like records, trying to get into like Double Door and everything else. Like,
yep.
Anything I could do. I was like 17 getting into these spots.
Can I tell the story from your first day you got into the Blue Groove Lounge?
Yeah.
Because you came with me.
Oh God, I know what story you're gonna say. I actually do know what story you're gonna say. So I'm.
Look, I've already said it, but to be fair, a lot of people know, but if you don't want me to tell it, I won't tell it.
Considering I'm such a nice
But gentleman, if you don't tell it, we're going to Google it.
Yes.
Well, luckily that one you can Google.
All right.
It was before any era of like me having a place to chill.
But you had the phrase no chill was invented this moment.
I was a wild.
Oh, you was out. Dude, you was a wild kid. So you come in and whatever, you were rolling with us. I think I might have been with Juice. I'm going to tell it anyway.
Oh, good Lord.
All right. So Carlos will appreciate this. So Carlos,
did you just watch me? Did you just see me? If you guys saw me on camera, I did one of these real quick.
Checking back. Don't worry, this is recorded. She's gonna watch it.
Let's check the chat room, see if she's listening.
So,
like, killing me out here. Like,
so, I think I might have been with Juice. I can't remember.
I will articulate it as best as possible. I was at the time a young lad who had met a female, and I didn't have any place to go, and Risky had a car, and it was cool. It was nothing crazy, like, not that I recall. So we're all right.
Oh, well, you get in.
Next story.
No, I'm talking about
Risky's like, I wasn't even telling that story. You're just bragging now.
No, I'm talking about when you got into the double door the first time. That's what I'm talking about. And so Prime's just super hype, right? He's like, yo, and I think I was with Juice and Prime came with us. And I'm like, oh, you're 21 now. You can get in here. Bruno's going to let you in. And you're like, word. So we go in. Prime's like looking around. He's like, all right, who do I battle first? I need to stake my claim. I need to make sure that everybody knows who Prime is within 3 minutes of me walking in this place. So he gets in there, and a bunch of people are rapping in a circle, and Prime's like,
that was the Blue Groove Lounge.
Yeah, it was Double Door, Blue Groove Lounge. Dude, I'm positive. Monday night.
You know, you're right, it was Double Door. I don't know why I didn't think of that as Blue Groove Lounge. I thought I was thinking another spot.
Yeah.
Never mind. All right.
Yeah, so, you know, Prime, this is Prime coming through, like, you know, it was packed Monday night, and then he sees a circle of people rapping, and there is Prime in the middle, and he's going at it, and he looks at this dude, and this tall, skinny dude is standing there, and he's bobbing his head, and I don't even think he's rapping. He's just sitting there. Prime just goes.
He was rapping.
Was he rapping? Okay. Well, but he's not really a rapper. He was just enjoying himself. And Prime's right. Like, man, I'm going to kill this dude. I'm going to go at this dude. He didn't even instigate anything. And Prime's like, I'm going to get that dude. So Prime just starts dismantling this guy. And he's like, what? And he's like, I'm not even a battle rapper. And he's like, I don't even understand what's going on. And Prime's just blah, blah. I'm like, yo, Trey, chill out. And he's like, nah. And he's going at it. And I'm like, yo. And I'm like, dude, that's Phantom, the producer from Rubber Room. He's not even a rapper. Like, and Prime's like, oh, man. He's like, really?
I was like, saw it too. I was like, man, could have got beats? Like,
he's like, man, I'm sorry. I didn't even know.
Yeah, no, I was, that's just crazy. I got raised like that. Like, when it came for me starting to listen to hip hop, like, that's exactly what I had to do to get props. So coming into the door, I think I definitely took that to, like,
oh, you?
12.
You were at 12.
What do you no? What the Dre? What do you think? Moments. What do you think put that edge on you so early on? Why? How'd you get that in you?
So it's crazy because I talk to people about kind of like looking at the scope of like why I'm like the dude I am with some of that stuff. So I think the first actual like people that were like homies that I felt comfortable being cool with were like these misfits over at Lane Tech that were listening to hip hop music, and like they were rappers, so we would get in cyphers, and it would always be like me getting checked, like it would be me getting served, or like I didn't know records, so I would get clowned on that, and like that was how I understood I was gonna get props, was to actually go in and battle and like stand out and do that. And I think the first time that I was like successful at it or like snapped back at somebody, the amount of attention that I got, considering I was somebody who like growing up, I'm like, you know, first generation, my parents are immigrants, they were keeping me locked up. So I would never really talk to people or kind of get out. So I think the first time when somebody really like cheered me on about that, the rush was so crazy that coupled with the fact that I thought I had to do that to earn my props, like took it to a whole different level. Like, and I never, it's kind of, it's probably, I would say like a decade for sure of like just living off of like getting all that props and attention off of that and getting like confident about myself. Like it really was like looking at it now, I see all those different components, but back then it was just like, I got to get my name up. I need to be the best dude out here. I will battle anyone who's even got like a ball cap on because they rap.
How many siblings do you have?
I've got, so it's kind of, I've got one younger brother and I had an older half brother. He passed away. Mm-hmm. And I've got two older half sisters. So I didn't grow up with any of my half siblings. It was just prime. Growing up, it was me, my brother, my mom, my pops in like a small apartment, me and my brother, like mm-hmm. in one bedroom, like to the point that we kind of, even to this day, we're cool, but it's not like the happiest. Cause you put these
Don't
two little people
socks,
like,
son.
Yeah. Crazy. Like, yeah. So yeah. And my parents,
because you here, we're going to go professional psychology on you. You have the perfect symptoms of a middle child. You have the middle child syndrome to the T. And I know because I have that, where you have to come at people. If there's something that you want, you go and get it. And if it's attention, you guys are just going to have to give attention. So it's really cool to see how your childhood played such a big part of you being such a successful rapper. Cause you were fearless.
Well, it's crazy you say that. Cause like, I don't think about, like, I guess growing up, I hadn't thought about how the older siblings are. So, cause I am a middle child, right? Like thinking about it, I've mm-hmm. never, so you're saying it, but like legit everything I've ever needed, like whatever you're going to do, like go in and do it and work hard. And like, and I think I've got that ethic with everything I've ever done. So I know I've applied that. But now that you're mentioning, I kind of see definitely those characteristics. So that's pretty, it's pretty bugged out to think about it, actually.
You're welcome. That one's free.
Thanks, Dr. Phil.
Next hour is $250.
Yeah. Right. That's,
yeah. No, but I'm like Cleo. I'm like Miss Cleo in this video.
No, but it was like, it was crazy though. Cause like you said, you talking about it, I think about it. I grew up, the earliest I can remember was in Wicker Park before it was like gentrified. So it was like all Latin Kings out there. My parents would be like, mm-hmm. you're not going out. Like you're staying in there reading books. And, I think some of that like pent up energy and not being able to kind of like show that out when I finally was able to start going out to do shows or like even to sneak out to like a club or a house party or a basement party, like mm-hmm. it was like a shot out of a cannon because I'd been so like pent up before that, like straight up.
So your first like realm, like adventure into the hip hop culture was battling and that kind of stuff, right? That was kind of how you got introduced, how you got into everything.
So kind of, so when I was living in like the apartment, right, the landlord, like the kid, he had two kids and they lived above us. And I would always hear like Slick Rick and NWA and not know that that's what it was. I would just hear like the bass mm-hmm. and like I'd hear like Easy and like everybody else rhyming. So I never understood it, but I'd hear it and kind of dig it. And then like I know the moment that I decided I want to rhyme. It was a babysitter was actually playing a cassette tape and like, you know, those old school like little sound systems, right? I think once we got the glass door and you click it and open the glass door and put the little cassette in at the back then. And yeah, so like the first, I just remember the first time I knew I wanted to be a rapper was when she had put in Bigger and Deafer and I heard I'm Bad for the first time. And I was like, mm-hmm. that's what I want to do. Like, I want to be that dude. And that just kind of was the beginning of that. That and like Slick Rick, all of that really got me so into it as a fanboy that when I got to high school and started meeting people that were actually doing it and was able to kind of go to like Navy Pier and battle people or go to like the Taste of Chicago and meet other rappers or like, you know, running into Pugs and everybody else. Like, I knew I wanted to do it so bad that every time I would meet anybody else that was even close to rhyming, like it was like, where's the cypher? Let's do it. I got to show you what I learned this week. Like, it was pretty crazy when I started getting into it.
So what was your first experience going into a studio or putting down some recorded stuff?
The earliest one that I can recall was with Mix Massacre. There was a small little joint called Made in Heaven that was located. I didn't know this until after. It was located by one of my old grade schools that I went to. And it was like this little, it was like legit, like empty warehouse, dingy little spot. You walk in and like, it was like the beginning of like Ghost Hunters, and then you finally get to the studio. It was like, now looking at back at it. So it was cool because that was probably the first time that like I felt I was in the studio when I was recording. And it was when we were first started recording like the Mind Over Madness cassette. So that was like the first actual thing I put out. I think we did all of that there. Then got the little cassette printed out, got the little hit Kinko's back in the day, got the little cover, and then I hit the Taste of Chicago and started like slanging them. Like, sell, like it would be battle, sell tapes, battle, sell tapes. Like, that was it every that day. That was the.
Jay, but you know, for
Chad's 45 minutes, Chad's 45 minutes on that CD just gave up.
Right, little did you know,
you gotta go get another compy serve disc, son.
But I mean, like a lot of people, like Navy Pier was like, was the spot, man. That was where battlers lived.
I mean, you can't think about it. You can't do that now.
Yeah.
Right. Like back then, we were like running downtown. Like if it was a Take Chicago Navy Pier, you would see kids like the way they had these little, like, you know, a couple years ago, you'd see little mobs of kids like running around. Like we legit would run the whole city. And it was how a North Side kid like myself could meet somebody from the South Side, like Inglewood, that was actually like a graph writer or any kind of MC like that. I know I met Pugs on Jackson and State.
Yeah.
Like I remember every time I go to Jackson and State, I'm like, that's exactly where like the NACRO part of like my life started. You know what I mean? Like, so there's so many times now when I walk downtown that it just like feels smaller because of how often we would be there. Like Navy Pier, I know for a fact, it was like every Friday night, every Saturday night, battling at least like 20 people a night, like walking from one end of the pier to the other. And if there was any kind of cipher, which there always were, it was like hopping from one to the other, making sure that like I left my mark. And that's kind of, you know, that got me to see other parts of the city and like go visit like where Pugs and everybody's at. You know what I mean? Go to the point.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't do that now. Like, think about how that would occur now. Like, where would everybody meet up to even have that kind of understanding of like the whole city?
What was the Burger King? That was a pretty famous. The infamous Burger King. Yep.
Saturday mornings, NACROBAT meetings over at Burger King. Yeah.
State Street, right? I got a picture. Sorry? I think I sent you a picture. I have a picture of in front of that Burger King, you and the scam artist.
Yo, and yep, that's right by there. Like, I was a crazy looking kid back then too, man. Like, like I said, meeting Pugs kind of allowed me to like understand what it was like to be in a crew, like, and then have some, like, you know, was it 2 weeks ago when he did his interview here and he started talking about like the 200 people army. Like,
yeah,
it legit that big. Like, none of that is exaggeration. Like, everywhere you would go, you would meet people that were NACRO, and you're like, oh, you're down too. And there's so much power in that network, and the way that got established, like, it's really pretty sick.
One of the vignettes we did is Off-White. Did you see Off-White's vignette when he's referring to how his entrance into NACROBATS was he was in a circle and he was battling and Pugs didn't say a word to him. Pugs just looks at this guy and goes, go get him.
Yep.
You know, go after him. And then he did. Explain to people how that actually, you know, that's what it was, man. There wasn't even communication with Pugs. He was just like, go kill him.
Well, so I'll tell you what was crazy is when I met Pugs, I already had a rep. So like, he met me and was like, oh, like that's the little like Latino kid that raps. Like, that's how unique it was compared to like the crowds of people you'd see everywhere. So like it was ciphers where he would see me, and like I remember seeing him on Jackson State. Like, he knew how I got down, so immediately was like, yo, like, this is what we're doing, like, you should be a part of that. Like, and I at first I was like, I wanted to be down with the whole unit, but I was such a like whack, like little battle snob that I'd be like, well, is everybody dope? Like, who do they sound like? You know, like, I had always been like that. So when me and Pugs really got together, like, it really was a brotherhood where I was like this little bro, like, trying to, like, and I was the one you didn't have to point and tell somebody to go battle. I was the one, like,
Pugs. He's already killing people.
Yeah, Pugs would be like, yeah, you can chill. And I'd be like, no, where's he at? Like, where's
I got him. I got him.
You were the dog they kept on the chain, man.
Huh.
Truly. I was like, if they even mentioned Knack and didn't, like, give the respect, like, I was like, I'm going in. I don't care because I just need a reason. Like, that's for sure how I used to get in. Like,
did you see how we were talking about that House of Blues battle? Where do you remember that? I think you was there too when Robust got knocked out as Robust and he re-entered. He went back and re-entered his bus row.
Yo, yo, Bus was like, I mean, the amount of heart that kid had and the amount of humor, like, straight up, he would do.
Oh my god,
where he would do that. I'm like, that's not the only battle he'd get in twice. Like, I've seen him jump in and do it at, like, little, like, basement battles. Like, I'm back. Like, it was – that's why when I met him, like, and Pug said it exactly right. Like, the first stuff he was recording sounded, like, exactly Big L style. Like, really good, though. Not like, in a bite kind of mode, but, like, the punchlines were solid.
Like, influence.
Yeah, you could totally hear it. And then seeing this little dude come up, I was like, yo, I gotta, like, let's roll.
If,
like, let's, wherever we gotta go, you're coming with, because it's really cool to watch.
If you don't know who Robust is, try to find his debut CDR. Freelance gynecologist. Please. Find that was the name of the record, and it has some amazing records on it. One of my favorites being the mullet rap.
Yo, I mean, that guy, the personality on that was just crazy. No, it was really dope.
Oh, for sure.
So what's that rush like? Like, when you're about to go in on someone? Because this is something that always does amaze me when people are going straight off the top. We're not talking, because you always see these knuckleheads holding their phones and stuff like that. Like, what goes through your head when you're about to go in on someone? Are you thinking about their mom, thinking about their shoes? Like, what is it that triggers your fury?
Yeah, no, I mean, you heard me talking about it, how amped up I got. So it was like, there's always like this, like legit.
Are you like,
like, I know I'm going to be in the center right now, and I know that every single person through these multi-layers of this cypher in this crowd, like, we used to battle outside of Rock and Roll McDonald's, and there'd be, like, 70 people deep just watching. And, like, you would know, like, I'm going in, I'm making sure every single person that's in here understands, like, why I'm dope. And so whenever somebody would get there, like, you'd be in a cypher, right? And then you kind of, like, immediately – like, stake out, like, who's there, like, who's solid, who's dope, and you, it's really crazy. What you would see is, like, oh, this guy is definitely, thinks he's doper than he actually is. Like, you would see who that person is, and, like, wait, and there would be moments where I'd, like, kind of, like, come in, like, sheepishly, or, like, hey, how's it going, guys, like, because I would know.
Like Billy Hoyle?
Yeah, like, exactly, like, if somebody was feeling themselves, and, like, they'd probably say something, because I'm the one that looks different in the crowd. And I'd be like, yo, homie, like, yo, you messed up. Like, I was waiting for that. So it's always like this real, like, yeah, it's like this super solid, like, kill instinct. And, like, when it comes to, like, the freestyle portion, like, the top of the head, like, it absolutely is what you just said. Like, it's like your radar kicks in and you're just like, what am I talking about? Who does he look like? What's he wearing? Why? This is ridiculous. This dude didn't even brush his teeth today. Like you would literally, like, within seconds start, like, picking that apart. And then as you're forming, like, these thoughts, you're putting together couplets immediately. You're just like, I know this, this, and this. I'm about to go in and take these shots. And as you're freestyling, like, you have those in the back pocket if you need it to kind of, like, be like the uppercuts. But
yeah,
because your first 20 seconds doing it, you lose grasp of everything you were trying to think about. So now you're flying without a net and you're just like, all right, everything that I saw, let me hone back in on and find a way to tie it back in together as I'm rhyming everything else. And let me make sure I'm shouting out the crowd and bringing that in. But you just know, like, the difference between, like, the cyphers and, like, how people battle now, or even, like, some of the stage battles that would happen over beats, is, like, a person wouldn't be able to get six bars in if they weren't solid. Like, the second it would trail off, I'm cutting in, or they're cutting in on me. Like, it would be so contentious that it really had a different kind of energy to it that I think in watching the other battles, like, they're all dope, but it's so hard to capture what that felt like in a cypher, because then somebody comes in out of nowhere and they're jumping in because they think they're better than both of you guys, and now you're battling three dudes at the same time that, like, it's really hard to capture it, and the amount of, like, adrenaline you get doing it is, like, insane. No joke.
Huh.
Who was the toughest? Go ahead, Ryan.
I was gonna say, who's
the toughest person that you ever battled?
I know that.
No, I mean, so I was a pretty clever and smart kid as far as, like, knowing kind of what my lane was. My lane was a wide one.
Right. You see how his internet is acting up when you ask him about his weakness?
But I knew, I'm trying to think. I mean, idea, obviously.
That's what I was going to say. That idea rap, like, that idea battle. Man, I still think you could have took idea. I just think you was just like.
Well, it's exactly what I was saying before. Like, in a cypher, like, idea and us in a cypher before Scribble Jam was completely different than being on stage and you gotta rhyme for a minute and, like, somebody else goes for a minute. Like,
that was your first major battle and you were a kid. I mean,
yeah,
like, I just felt like you let that get to you that moment, because I thought you could have took idea.
Well, it was, you know, I had never had, like, one of those, like, those battles happen in Chicago here and there, but never to the point that you could really train. And idea, like, let's not play. Like, that guy.
Idea is sick. He's killer.
Well, and he's also very disciplined in the training. So, like, when you watch him, like, in those battles, you know how much he was studying Juice. Like, you know exactly. Like,
yeah.
The way Juice would set up bars, like, he'd have the two, you know, two bars set up, then the two bars after is, like, the hit, right? So he'd always build it up. And idea got to the point where he took that same formula. And when he got really solid, it would be like every two would be a hit. And just the amount of, like, craftsmanship and investment. And he was way more comfortable being on stage because at that point, he'd already been traveling with Slug and, like, being, like, the hype man and making sure to, like, rhyme before. So the comfort level he had at the stage at that point, like, there was obviously a lot of work in and a lot of clear advantages considering, like, I'd never done that.
Sure.
So I was nervous as hell. Like, I was legit. Like, you look out at the crowd. And it's different being in a cypher surrounded by a crowd than when you're, like, on stage and there's, like, two of y'all, and then you look out and it's, like, hundreds. Like, it was, yeah. Even talking about it now, I'm like, yeah, I legit was, like, straight, like, a little anxious on it.
Oh, for sure. Like, I felt like going into it when you were going to do it. I remember when you were preparing for it. Like, I'm like, idea is super dope. He's sick, but I think you could take him. And then the VHS starts flying around and everybody kind of sees it because there was no internet then. We saw it back then. We saw the battle when you came back from Cincinnati. This was Scribble Jam. You the VHS passed around and you saw there wasn't DVDs. It was a VHS, and you were like, okay, so let's see what happened. And I was like, oh man, this guy could have had him. And he was like, but you could see the difference. Like you said, like I said, you were a kid and you kind of, that moment just, that was your, I mean, you hadn't even performed yet really, like, any major stages. So this was like the first big stage, and idea had already been so finely tuned that, he was able to hone, you know, he was able to go in and get to the jugular on you before you could even make your move.
And you could tell, like being you, I mean, you've seen me in, like, cyphers and battles. Like, I'm mad animated. I'm, like, moving around. Like, I feel the space. And if, like, I remember being on that stage and feeling, like, super still and not, like, comfortable, like, to move around or anything. And it's just, yeah, it was.
You reminded me of Rhymefest a lot, the way you moved, because Rhymefest moves a lot in his battles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, and Juice has, like, the one pace, the little pace bounce.
Yep. Yeah. So there's been a few battles that are very infamous that have your name attached to it that go in the lore of Chicago hip hop. But the Drunken Monkey battle was a big one.
Yeah. That, see, so that, like, so if you look at that one, like I'm for sure feeling myself, like the way that I'm kind of bouncing around and like, but to that, you know, that's a whole different stage, right? That's a stage that I had been doing for so long.
You were primed at that point, no pun intended.
Right. Hey-o. No, but, you know what I mean? Like, and you know, and Drunken Monkey's like this like energy, like this force that like,
that's, you know, the only way to describe that guy. He is literally a force of energy. If you don't know who Drunken Monkey is, man, he is a ball of energy that's just coming at you.
Yeah. Yeah. So I knew like I had to be at the same level or above that, or he would like squash it.
Right? Yeah, absolutely.
Like, yeah, no, that was definitely fun.
Then of course, you know, let's talk about your most infamous battle, I think would be the Blaze battle, which you won by, or you lost by winning.
Yeah, yeah. So this would be like the white man can jump episode. Sometimes when you win, you lose, and when you lose, you win.
Well, let's go. Let's go back to the Chicago. Let's tell the, you know, talked a little bit about the whole experience, about how you got involved, how, because it was a big thing for Chicago, and you were one of the big representatives for it. So
that started, I mean, through a lot of different ways, but like we were talking about the bog, like I met Breeze Everflowing there, and like him and I developed like a real strong like brotherhood where he was like, yo, like if you want to come to New York, like you can totally like stay at my spot. And you know, prior to that, I had been to like a couple rock steadies, and I'd gotten like my name up there through jumping in ciphers and like rhyming with Wordsworth and like mad other dudes. So I was like, New York was like a pilgrimage. It was like, I want to go as often as possible. So I went and hung out for about a week. And while I was there, he was like, Breeze was like, you know, MTV is doing this DFX battle. Like, and all you got to do is show up. Like, I'm going to be in it. Like, you could be in it. So that was my first exposure to kind of like New York and like outside of the city. So through that, I kind of became more aware of like the Blaze stuff. So when it was time for that to come into the city, like I was geeked. Like I think I'd been a little more seasoned as far as like some of the stage battles, like make sure that I was like top cool. It was like, and it was a dope battle. Like Quell was in that one. So it ended up being me and Idea going to New York for like the big Blaze battle. And that was,
and Vision went with you too.
Yeah, I met Vision there.
Yeah.
I didn't know him the Blaze battle. But that was really cool. Like it was like living like a reality show, I guess, you know, like it was like all these people from different, like it was a real world rap version. Like everybody's showing
up. Yeah, right.
Yeah, you're meeting each other and you're like, you've all come up under this same kind of culture. So you
12 rappers from different cities get together and live in a house.
Right. What do you do when things are real? All right. Yeah.
Prime is like, why you eat my toast, yo?
Huh? He said, why you eat my toast, yo?
Yeah, is that real? Dylan. No, but it was cool because we all got to know each other, and then like it was crazy because we would all team up but still kind of be eyeing each other the whole time. And like me and Vision would really like, me and Vision hit it off, or we would just crack jokes on everybody else. And then the night of the battle comes up and we're all there. We've done like whatever little press shootings. And I know that I'm going up and I think it's against Reese. And before I'm going to go on stage, like no joke, it was like, it had to be a crowd of like maybe 10 dudes roll up on me. And one of them was like, yo, like, I just want to let you know, like, you're going to lose this battle. You're out. Like, you're going to, he wasn't like saying it. He was like, no, like, I'm going to let you know
you're losing,
that you're going to lose because you're here. He was like, you're here in New York and you're from Chicago and nobody has your back. So trust me on, like, you're not going to win this one. Like, you feel me? So I already, like, they legit were just waiting to mob. And I'm like, okay, cool. So I knew, I'm like, if it's going to happen anyway, I'm going to have to kill her. So I'm like, let's go in and do it. And so I came out. And then we her and I are battling, like these dudes are backstage legit, like waiting. Her and I are going at it. I'm like going in. Like first it was dope because KRS came out and introduced, like KRS to me is like so much a part of like my DNA and how I grew up that I'm just like fanboy off top. So we're going out, we're battling. Like, it gets to the point that, like, I had gone in so hard off the first round that she's nervous doing her round. Like, she just couldn't even kickstart the verses that she already had in her head. So it got to the point that I felt so bad that I'm telling her, like, yo, it's all good. Like, you can totally start. And you can even see it on the tape. And she just, like, she's kind of choking and it's kind of choppy and she's messing up the bars. And then, so it's over. So they're basically going off a crowd meter, right? And, like, she was signed to, I don't think it was Priority. I forgot what it was.
She was on a major, though.
She had a street team in the first front row. Like, she had a street team was there because they were trying to build her up and the show was, like, a step in that, right? But when it came to the crowd meter, like, not only was that a factor, but, like, mad people were booing her because she had choked on stage.
You can watch the DVD, and they're booing so loud from her choking that she gets the meter to the max from booze.
Yeah, so because it went off of that noise meter, they gave her the win. And then, like, Tony Touch, who had been DJing, was like, y'all shouldn't have booed. Like, six. And so I'm, like, walking back off stage after that. I don't can't even describe the level of salty. I just know that somebody gave me a bottle of, like, so, because I'm saying I came from, like, Chicago, knowing what I, like, was capable of and knowing where I thought I was going to end up. Like, I'm like, yo, me idea, maybe vision, like, for sure, top two, and I'm going to figure that out. So in the first round, that goes down. I go backstage, ridiculous salty. And, like, the rest of the people backstage knew how salty it was, that, like, somebody just literally just gave me a bottle of Henny the second I hit backstage, and I'm like, I'm just getting wasted. Like, it was so that was really, like, super disappointing, right?
Oh, God, yeah.
And then I get back to the city, and everyone's like, you got jerked. Like, I saw it, like, you killed her, and you got, like, and then that became what I heard for, like, the next 4 years. Every time I'd see somebody, they'd be like, man, like, I was watching the people that never even, like, knew I rap would be like, man, I saw you, and you should have won. And, like, so it was, like, a good, like, consolation prize to kind of get that. But
dude, everybody from Chicago only bought the Blaze Battle Volume 1 DVD. They didn't even care about Volume 2.
I think the experience was dope, but, yeah, it was crazy, man.
Yeah, that was bogus. And then Idea ends up winning the thing.
Yeah, with a big old silver jacket.
Yeah, and it's funny because if people don't know, Carlos, what the prize was of the Blaze Battle was a recording contract with Bad Boy.
Yeah.
So they get Idea, and John Combs has got his arm around Idea, like, what the hell am I gonna do with this kid? Dude, it was so awkward and so, like, you could see Sean Combs going, oh, this isn't good.
And it was, like, the jacket, the Blaze Battle jacket, like, some Mace would wear in, like, a Biggie video. Like, it was, like, super shiny. And, like, I just know, like, no Midwest rappers were feeling it.
Oh, it was hysterical, dude.
I remember that. I remember seeing him there. Whatever came to that, did they even try to do anything with that? Did he go after somebody else? Like, what came of that? I don't remember.
I think it really ended up being, like, a mutual, like, this probably ain't going to work kind of deal.
So yeah, give me some money.
Man. It was just something that he could add to his resume while he was already building up his album and going touring and everything else. So,
yeah. Dude, I could imagine Puffy's face if he would have got, like, some demos from Idea. what he would have done.
Or if you try to imagine Idea over, like, Hitman beats or something. Like, it's just not
good. Oh, my God, yeah. Oh, Lord have mercy.
That was cool. Rest in peace too, man.
That's
cool, dude.
Yeah, rest in peace, Idea. He was a good dude.
Yeah.
He was a dope rapper, dope battle MC. He was a good artist overall. He was an artistic kid, so.
Yeah, family's cool. Mom.
How did that show?
Every show. I'm sorry.
I was just going to ask you, how did that show, if anything, how did that show help your career, your music career, when you came back home?
I mean, it kind of got me a little more notoriety. I mean, I didn't. I'm not kidding. I was, like, salty, like, legit salty coming back, because, you know, like, I'm a kid who, like, that was the shot. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, that was like, yo, somebody killed Bunny Rabbit before the movie finished. Like, that's like, All the dreams were done. Like, my 8 mile moment was over, right? So I think it put a real big – that's definitely part of the decision or part of what informed that decision where I was like, yo, I'm done. Like I did a couple scribble jams, but I was like, I much rather would figure out the recording and, like, making it something that I could live off of, because it ain't going to be battling. It's kind of how I – or it ain't going to be, like, sport battling.
You know, when let's the Chicago battle scene is very unique because so many people are off the top rappers here. Where that a lot of cities, they're not off the top. They're pre-written battles. But one of the places we talk about sub T 606. Talk about what 606 means to you, because you were a part of that for a long time.
Shout out to Jory too. Jory's been checking in online too.
So. Oh, dope.
Who's online?
Jory.
Oh, dope. Oh, sick. So, like, I think the best way to really think about Subterranean as I saw it was, like that's where that's I'm dope. Going in. Like, it is, like, legit, like, everybody rhyming, like, that. For me, specifically, I had a good, like, solid multi-year run of, like, if I'm walking into Sub-T, everyone that touches a mic is going down. I mean, I battled multiple people at the same time, 4 or 5 dudes, like, taking them out back to back. I mean, to the point that, and I'm not making this up, I know there was some dude I served that wanted to run me over once I walked out of Sub-T, try to throw drinks and me kind of flipping at a battle. Like, it was definitely where I would go to really hone that part of it. So it was different from the ciphers because it wasn't that same kind of energy, but it was very similar. And there was like a mic and a speaker and you could totally like clown people. That to me was like, I was like home. Like, I'd sit in there and just like pick people apart. I think sometimes it made me a little more vicious than I needed to be. But definitely fun. Like, I know that.
Let me ask you, Dre, if you had to put together the all-star starting five of Chicago battle rappers, who is it?
Juice. Fest. Pugs. Pugs doesn't get the credit that he deserves on the battle tip. I think people see Pugs making hats and stuff and whatever, and like, when Pugs is going in, like, he would go in. I'd be in the five, of course.
They see him making them dope ass hockey jerseys with basketball logos on them. You see that one, yo?
Did you buy that?
Here he goes.
I was waiting. I was waiting for the
credit card every 5 minutes.
You wanted us to do a Twitter poll on that? Still?
Yeah, we're supposed to do a Twitter poll. That's why when you guys didn't do the Twitter poll, I was like, sweet, I just saved $125 because it's on sale from a regular price, $175.
Actually, you know who would be the fifth dude, and I probably should have mentioned him sooner, is Rusty Chainz. Rusty Chainz is a
Rusty's a killer.
Monster. Like, and the thing, he's not just a monster back then. Like, the stuff he does now is so sick. Like, I mean, but there's so many. Like, Moose Swings is dope. You know what I'm saying? Like, Fresco's dope. There's so many dope. Like, I was thinking my era.
Yeah. No, for sure. Who's some of the people in this younger era that's killers?
I think Fresco's got it like locked. Like, he's so smart on how he picks apart things. He's so good at some of the setups, his delivery, the level of humor, like. Yeah, when I think about all the dudes that are out, I think he probably, to me, is one of the, like, favorite dudes I got, which is crazy because now, like, you guys know, I'm more of, like, a political, like, guy.
And you don't say.
Talking about that, and him and I don't agree at all.
No, tell us more.
Yeah, like, November 9th, he was celebrating. I was not. Like we're not on the same page there, but dude's a beast. Like, yeah, he's sick.
There was a couple other people that kind of like hit the scene really hard. Well, you know, Presence was a dude that was around for a minute and then he moved, he was gone, but he was dope. Flaps was really dope.
the top battling.
Profound's insane.
Dirty from TSP used to be like super sick. There's a lot of dudes, man. Like so, because Chicago was, it bred people to be really good at that. Like I think we always had a chip on our shoulder because we weren't one of the coasts, that we took a lot of pride in like doing things that were so like true hip hop to us. Like the Breakers were like solid, the Graph Riders were solid. So MCs had to be like all about being really dope off the head and like really super hip hop dudes, that there's this like solid core to everything that they're building, and like you would tear apart other people that didn't have that same DNA. And I'm like, yeah, it's a lot of solid. Ange is a beast. Like
Ange is a killer. Yeah.
Yeah. EC, like so many ill MCs. Like I'd something to be proud of. Chicago's got like such dope talent.
Absolutely.
It's been brought up a little bit. So recently, the prime rapper has matured a little bit and is now entering into a more political phase of his life. What so people don't know, what's your position now? How do you work with Chicago Progress? And I'm curious, what was there one thing that kind of made you like, man, I kind of want to go this direction? Was there something that what tipped you off into doing this? Because you're just amazingly active, and I love seeing that.
Yeah, so I am executive director of Chicago Progress, and that's basically an organization where I'm trying to get the word out about local government to kids like me, right? Who like through our school system and are just like street kids and everything else, like don't really know or understand politics. And it's really not their fault. Like they don't have any way to kind of learn that. So I really want to find a way to kind of get that information out to people, because I think it's the best way to help change our government. So I would say that where it all comes from is hip hop music. Like, I grew up, like I said, NWA, Public Enemy, KRS-One, J-Ru, Gangstar, Nas. Like, it's people who informed the world. Like, before I knew what it was, I was already aware of, like, social injustice and economic injustice and what it's like growing up in an environment where you don't have resources. Like, that's what hip-hop is, right? It's these street kids who didn't have what other kids have. Like when in New York, when they ended like the music programs and people didn't have instruments to play, they would then go to their parents' record crates and record players and bring that out and like and build a culture, right? Art and music and all this wealth of like creativity that comes out of that. And those same people then become really good at telling the story of what that environment's like, right? So when KRS-One is like telling you like, that's the sound of the police, that ain't because it sounded catchy, it's because that's what life is like, right? That's how you completely understand that everyone is dealt a different hand, and somehow you and everybody you know has got a whack one. And what do you do about that? So that's, like I said, before I even understood that was political, that was why part of hip hop to me, like, you know, my rapping was more getting a lot of that angst out through battling and through like, it was more punk than like trying to be kind of educational, but I still was informed by all that. So what was really crazy is that, you know, like I've said this to people, like if you came up during hip hop, like there was a time where I was a 5%er, right? There was a time where I grew up thinking that, you know, no matter what we did, our voice didn't matter. Voting didn't matter. Like that stuff was predetermined, and the Illuminati, like these are concepts that we all learned through hip hop music that became exactly how we view things, right? And I was pretty comfortable with that, but I knew that that's always a part of who I was on how I learned things. Now, then 2008, like, this black guy runs for president. And that was against everything I had been taught about how the system is like gamed. Because if it was that gamed, he should have never been able to get in the door, right? So that to me is like a glitch in the matrix where I'm going, I'm going to start paying a little more attention to things. So I start watching like West Wing and like paying attention to the news and like social media, starting to kind of get information. Like, yo, like that's how I learned all of this stuff, right? To be, you know, and that's how people pick stuff. Cause I went to UIC and I wanted to be an English teacher, but that didn't pan out because it was boring the first 2 years. And I just didn't know how to assimilate into like the whole college life. So I didn't, sure. You know, I took a couple of courses in political science and criminal justice then, but, and nobody knew that because I'm here battling people all the time. So nobody could even tell that that's the same dude doing all that stuff. Crazy. So, yeah. So Obama starts running. I start becoming like someone involved. Like I remember Shabazz over at the basement has like this rap van. It's got Obama on it. And I'm like with him riding in it around Grant Park when Obama wins, when he does the first speech when he's elected president. So I start paying attention to that and being a little more aware. You know, I'm at that point, I'm working like in a corporate environment. So I'm a little more like settled in. I'm like in my 30s and like kind of like, okay, like tell everybody guys, like, you know, like the rapper stuff that done run its course a little bit. I mean, my wife, you know, one kid and another, that's how it works out. So, yeah. So we're looking at this most recent election, right? And, you know, at this point, President Obama is kind of a bit of a disappointment, to be honest, but completely fair. Like, I think I, like a lot of other people, had projected all these hopes and dreams on this one dude. Like, ultimately, it's one guy who we, because he was such a transformational figure, like, you put so much on him that he just wasn't going to live up to. And some of that is, like, not knowing who he actually was compared to how you view the symbol.
Right. Well, the one thing with that, though, is that, like, too many people look at everything as being black or white, and 99% of everything is gray. Like, there's always multiple sides to everything, and, yeah. You know, I'm kind of like you. Like, I'm probably a little bit more optimistic than I should be about things, but I'm kind of like you. What you were saying earlier is that, like, when Obama got elected, that went against everything that most of us, or that a lot of us, thought how the system was. So because of that fact, that gives me a little bit more hope. Now, we're going to have a giant-ass hole to dig out of here in the next year, the next 4 years, and it kind of depends on how deep that damn hole is. But I'm optimistic on the future for what you were saying earlier, is that now we've got the hip-hop generation coming up. And yeah. I say that not because we're going to get a president in there that's going to be rapping fuck the police, but I'm saying that we've got a hip-hop generation that's now starting to become more involved and get into that age to make that difference and to get involved in these things. And they're coming from a place of inclusion and a place that just brings people together. And that I think is very powerful.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think you're absolutely right. Like, every generation is more progressive than the one before it, right? Like, they're more willing to kind of push the envelope and take risks. So, and I look at me, like, I'm this like battle rapper who suddenly like starts learning this stuff, and everything that I had gone through in my experience, like, you know, I got arrested twice, right? And one, this was before I was 18. One time I got arrested, it was me, and like it was Chaos, Mr. MC, and I forget the third because it's so long ago, but like they're smoking weed on Michigan and Ohio. Right, like where the steps are. And I hadn't at that point even tried that stuff yet. And I'm sitting there with them, like a block, you know how like the there's like these block steps where you kind of sit? Yeah. I'm like sitting a step below them. So I'm sitting a step below them and the cops roll up. And immediately they're like, what are you guys doing? And they straight up start arresting like the three African-American friends and like act like I'm not even there. Like they don't even understand how we could possibly be rolling together. Mm-hmm. And they're oblivious to the fact that I'm there. Like, I legit had to raise my hand, and I'm like, I'm with these guys, and that's how we all got locked up together.
And then we're
feeling like reservoir dogs in a little jail
cell. And you learned a very valuable lesson that day.
Shut your mouth.
Like, do not talk, period.
Right. No, but I mean, at that moment, I think I know what it is that they're looking. They're completely not thinking about me, and I see the profiling going on at that young level.
Absolutely, yeah.
And the second part is, like, as a hip-hop dude, like, how weak is it if I just, like, don't go down with the crew, and the next time I see him, I got to be like, whoa, what was that like, guys? So I just
– right.
You know what I mean? So I think all these experiences kind of inform how I look at, like, the world. So all of a sudden, like, Hillary's going to run, and I'm like, okay, it's I think that it's cool that we should get a female head of state, because symbolically that's another level of, like, evolution, right? We've got first an African-American president. Let's get a female head of state. Like, that's dope. Then I'm hearing, like, Elizabeth Warren. I like what she's saying. And then Bernie, right? This guy says everything that I have agreed with since becoming a hip-hop dude and, like, understanding how we're getting played, right? And he's, like, the only person. And initially, I'm like, man, people are going to see this dude, and he looks like he's, like, you know, 138 years old. And nobody, and I'm like, you know, I'm being cynical, and I'm like, nobody's gonna buy it. Like, nobody's, he's right about everything, but are people gonna get it? Mm-hmm. He starts building momentum on Facebook, and I'm like, I'm gonna let all the hip hop people I know that follow me, because I'm prime, like, learn about this guy. And I start posting, and, like, people are hitting me up going, like, I never heard of this guy. Like, I like what he's saying. Like, and now I'm putting people on. On to, like, rappers, like, yo, you guys, you gotta hear this Bernie dude, yo, this joint is sick. And you know, but people are catching on. People are like, man, I like what he's saying. So this woman I knew from back in the day when I used to go, like, be drunk battling 40, like, you, she sees me posting all this stuff, and she's like, my brother is an alderman. So her brother is Alderman Carlos Ramirez Rosa, who's, like, legit out of all the aldermen, like, one of the most progressive, like, he is a democratic socialist. And they invite me because she goes, I see what you're doing. I can get you in to see Bernie talk as a local Latino leader. And I'm like, all right, so I'm local, I'm Latino, 2 out of 3 ain't bad. Let's go do it. So I go to see Bernie, I meet Bernie, and I just, like, I got so serious. Like, it's really crazy. There's a couple people that I've met that when I meet them, like, changed the way of my life. Like, being able to record with KRS-One changed my life. I knew at that moment I don't have to rap anymore. Like, that was crazy for me. And then so meeting Bernie kind of was the same kind of, like, I just knew it was transformational. So I decided to go to Iowa. I started hitting up random people on Facebook. 3 of us got together to go to Iowa and start knocking on doors. We do phone banking. And then I take all of these skills that I had learned from, like, being an MC. I learned also how to become a promoter and, like, throw shows. So I'm like, let me put together a show so I can get people who typically aren't paying attention to politics to, like, come out, have some performers and, like, rock out. Like, Shadow was performing. Graffenberg, who, you know, originally G-Spot, was performing. And I knew I could get people who knew me as Prime to come out and meet some of these community organizations. And I did it the day before the primary so that people would have it fresh in their head and be able to go vote the next day. So Bernie announces that he's gonna go talk at Chicago State the exact same time I got this event. I put in, like, 3 G's. I'm trying to get everything going. And he announces that he's gonna be there somewhere else. And I'm like, yo, I'm legit gonna go broke off of, like, this one event I did. And it ends up selling out, 300 people show up, we break even, get $750 for his campaign through a live art auction. So I had Demon was doing artwork at Burnfest, and just, like I said, I was tapping into all my hip hop connections and, like, trying to bridge it all together. And then I met Amanda Weaver, who's the executive director of Reclaim Chicago. She saw what I was doing. Like, I'm legit talking to people and introducing everyone and kind of hosting everything. And she's like, what are you doing next? And I'm like, I don't have a next. This was my plan. This was my grand scheme. People came, I got them voting. I hope he wins. And she tells me, she's like, you don't understand. Or, like, you brought all these people yourself to come do this and support this. And whether you recognize it or not, what you're doing right now is community organizing. And all of a sudden I take all these talents and skill sets that I've had and start applying it to that and start meeting other people. And I just connect to different people differently. Cause I'm like, stuff aren't used to being on stage or talking to people or don't have that comfort level. I'm somebody who like lived in a crowd that I can kind of tap into that part of who I am to get a message across. And, you know, through everything that happens in the primary, like Bernie kind of got jerked to not win the primary because everyone in the Democratic Party was pretty much like in it to get Hillary elected to win that.
Right.
And my firm belief is if they wouldn't have gotten involved and just let it run the way it runs, Bernie wins and we move forward, or Hillary wins legit and we all kind of come together instead of what actually happened, right? Like, as much as people want to blame like Comey and the Russians and everything else, the stuff that's in the emails was legit. Like, they were giving her questions to debates before the debates were coming on. They were putting debates where people weren't watching. So there was so much like low-key shady stuff going on that people seeing it got it and got super turned off about trying to be supportive, especially when we had a candidate that we viewed as like flawed. Like, if Trump was the most unfavorable candidate in history and you're trying to win, you don't decide to put up the second most unfavorable, like, hey, I think we got him. Like, that was just not.
Well, yeah, strategy. And then you put someone like Trump, who's a reality TV star, and he's got more money than anybody. And I mean, it's.
Well, not even that. Like, you've got somebody who's so well-trained and so understands media and understands attention. Because if you look at how much he spent, half of what Hillary spent.
Yeah.
Like, so he didn't even.
I didn't even know that.
He knew that if he said something crazy, CNN's going to play it all day, every day. Exactly. The remix coming up every hour. And trying to say that. Here's the problem. When you have two candidates that the American public has known for over two decades, you're not surprising anybody, right? You can't say like, oh, it's Trump. It's crazy old Trump, when everyone's like, I know who this guy is. Like, yeah, he's quirky, he's crazy, but I'm almost like, you know, you're so familiar with that person that you don't think about the unintended consequences. And what you provided the American people were subpar options. Like,
that's the saddest thing for me, is that the fact that people know Trump, like, we all kind of knew what we're getting into, right, with Trump. And what's sad is we go from someone like Barack, while he may have not have, you know, changed with his policies, he may have not have, like, hit home runs every time. We're going to someone who is flat out immoral, unethical. And
can we go back to the part where you guys keep saying, where you guys keep saying Barack didn't really quite for you, but Barack really quite reached the people who needed health care, the people
you misunderstand.
Really,
I don't want you to get
the
that.
World. He really changed the world for gay people. He really changed the world for a lot of people, just because he didn't. And I know I'm just putting this out there. And I know that you guys are going to check me a little bit, but this is more for the people that are listening, saying, yeah, he didn't do shit for me. It's because the people that he did change needed that change so badly. Those are the people that he helped. He would have been able to go deeper with the cuts if he was able to go deeper with the cuts. But my man was working his ass off with just dead people dragging him down.
All right, so I'm gonna counter that, and I want to say, like, I have a lot of respect for President Obama. Like, it's not an easy job, right? But so let's look at the first week of President Trump. That guy must have passed like 52 executive orders in a week.
That's all he does.
Like, I'm saying the whole party had everything. They had everything ready to go. They've got these executive orders. They've got their plan set. The day he walks in, they're like, bam, 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 right?
Right.
Now, President Obama, overwhelming mandate. Like, he won a ridiculous lead off the top the first time. He has 2 years of a Congress that's going to have his back. It's a Democratic Congress. And he's taking all of his political capital and focusing on two things, on bailing out the country because these bankers ruined our economy, right?
Right,
and
which he did.
And healthcare. So, like, if you look at what Trump's done as far as like pushing in 82 things or whatever, had Obama done the exact same thing, he would have gotten so much more accomplished in the first 2 years, along with the healthcare, that I think most people would have been riding for him. Right? They would have been like, so man, this guy.
I don't disagree with that, but to me, I've always looked upon that as he was fairly young. People were already giving him shit for being very inexperienced and stuff like that. If he were to come in and be so aggressive like that, it's quite possible that could have killed any chance for another black president in the near future. So I get playing that a little bit cautiously.
You have to play the game because they're already talking about bringing charges to Trump and impeachment. Like, people are forecasting his impeachment because he's just pulling executive order after executive order. He's not checking to see how legal they are. He's not checking to see exactly how much that shit's going to cost.
So the hip hop part of me is going to say this whole thing is planned out. And what I mean by that is it's not even him. Like, the whole Republican Party is like, yo, that guy can go crazy. We've got all levels of government now. We've got the House. We've got the Senate. We're going to get the Supreme Court. If we could impeach this guy, and now Pence is running.
See, that's exactly like, it, because they're completely set up. Pence is their golden boy. They're using Trump right now to push those crazy agendas that they do. They'll get it to a point, and then they'll get things. I can almost guarantee that they'll at least go through the proceedings of an impeachment. Whether it actually goes through and that happens, it remains to be seen. But I think we're definitely on that. They're gonna use him right now to push through everything they can, blame it on him. It's all gonna be set. They'll throw him aside, and then it's Pence running things for either the rest of this administration or how they're going forward.
So that's the part that's like the most frustrating, is when you're looking at these two parties like teams. One knows how to play chess, and the other one's never even heard of checkers.
Like, yep,
right.
the Republican Party is so smart about utilizing this anger and this fear and really strategically placing themselves. Like, they don't believe half the stuff they're fighting for, but they know their base is going to be amped up. Meanwhile, on our side, we want to be above it all and not fight and say, hey, why can't we get friends? When they're saying off the gate, we're not going to agree with anything you want.
Right.
And, you know, so that's a problem. But we've seen 8 years of that. And now we got Trump, and we still have Democrats going, well, you know, I'm going to vote yes on some of these confirmations that aren't the real crazy ones. Instead of really being gangster and saying, you did 8 years of stuff, we can't get anything.
Yeah.
So straight up, I don't care what you're talking about.
Prime, I agree with you. I have a hard time believing that they even believe in their own crap. I can't even comprehend that. You know, I know some of these people are smart. They're Republicans, but they're smart dudes. And I know, and I just, I'm having a hard time comprehending that some of them even believe in it. Like you said, this is all part of the plan.
And I'm gonna help you. I'm gonna go to the next level of like this hip hop. Yo, I'm doing the knowledge, right? Like, these people have the same owners. Like, every single one of them, once they get in office, their main goal is getting reelected. Because big donors and these PACs are paying them off, like, you're not going to go that hard. Like, here's something else that's a huge disappointment, right? President Obama comes in, the recession and what the bankers did to our economy, the amount of homes lost, the amount of foreclosures, the amount of people going bankrupt, losing their jobs, going broke. And nobody gets arrested. Not one ever gets arrested. So, like,
you. Meanwhile, you can drive your hoopty down the street with this little shavings of a dime bag in your car, and you do a dime.
Right. So when we talk about President Obama, you can say,
you know who got arrested? Martha Stewart. Martha Stewart got arrested.
But you know what I mean? Like, you can say President Obama did a lot of great things, but you can also look at it and say, like, that not arresting anybody, like, that's crazy, right? Or the fact that he deported the most amount of people out of any president. Like, none of that's – so here's what I would say. I'd say when we look at this election, you got people who, because of policies by Democrats and Republicans for the last 30 years, are starving. Losing their jobs. The trade policies took everybody's jobs, right? People can go get everything made in China, so we can't. And what's really grimy about that is that not only are you shortchanging the American people because you're taking those jobs, but the people in China don't even get a proper life for the labor they're putting in, right? They're being paid pennies and they aren't even able to get a good life. So these are so greedy and so grimy that they don't really, they don't care, right? They're cool with everybody getting arrested because that's more free labor. So let's make marijuana. Let's keep marijuana illegal, even though it's less dangerous than alcohol, right? So, you know, there's a lot of things that I think that the American people get. We understand it. We know we're getting jerked. We know, like when Hillary was getting paid $200,000 for a speech and she's telling people like, I told them after the recession that they better cut it out. It's like nobody buys it. So, like seriously, like if you're somebody, you know, and they made this big story about like the rural white voter in the Midwest. It's not that they're rural white voters. It's that they're broke. Like it's broke people.
They have no jobs.
That, you know, when you look at them getting screwed by both parties, they were just anti-establishment and were going to vote and reflect at anything that wasn't. And what we provided them was the living embodiment of that establishment in Hillary Clinton and like this loose cannon anti-establishment Trump. So there's people who are probably like, you know what? I'm tired of my life getting screwed for the last decade and I'll be damned if my kids have to go through it. I'd rather throw a grenade at it than keep doing the status quo because nobody cares about us.
I don't necessarily disagree with that, but I as much as I would love to see certain things get blown up, to me there is a difference between, you know, throwing a small grenade on a problem and throwing a nuclear bomb on the problem. And as much as I did not like Hillary, I fully would have won. I wanted her over. I would have rather her kept a status quo for 4 years, and then hopefully the next one is going to be a progressive Elizabeth Warren or Bernie if he decided to run again or something like that, as opposed to this. Because even if he's only around for 4 years, it's going to be. It's going to be.
Right, but the thing is, he promised. You know, he's like, I'm a corporate guy. I make jobs. Yeah. Right. And that if you don't have a job and you don't see a future for your kids, that sounds attractive. So I actually take my hat off. I actually take my hat off for those people in the middle class who voted for him because of that, because it takes an extraordinary amount of balls to do something as drastic as this. And I wish the other side would have done the same thing and actually voted for Bernie. So it would have been Bernie or this knucklehead, because at least we would have the extremes on both sides, and let's see who wins.
And to Ryan's point, right? Like, I agree. Like, I voted for Hillary because to me it was a very clear choice in the general election, right? Like, but when somebody's starving and hurting, like they don't think about anything but the fact that they can't put food on the table, and they get so emotional angry that they do that without thinking about it. And meanwhile, you've got, you know, Hillary's big slogan is I'm with her, and Trump is going, I'm with you,
right?
I've got your back. These people are taking everything you've got. I'm gonna build a wall. And like, so much to people that are hurting and like scared and don't know what the next day is gonna look like, he's just the better salesperson, right? Like, that's
right,
ultimately the problem and why we're here now. Here's the silver lining on that. I think if Hillary would have won, it would have been like the end of Return of the Jedi. Like, little Ewoks are running around. Everyone's like, we did it. Oh, we survived and we're great. And nothing would have changed. Like, it would have been complete status quo. At least now, and like I said, this is small silver lining compared to how horrible what this guy is doing and could ruin our country doing, right? Is that everybody woke up. Right. Everybody's going, what the hell just happened? Exactly. We just had 250,000 people out in downtown Chicago rallying together because they think it's, and you know, like, think about how he actually won. Less than half of the American public voted, and less than half of that got him elected. Yeah. There's so many more of us that if we really get organized and like do the stuff that we were talking about as hip hop kids, and like, we're going to change the system and all that. Like, if we really were about it, we would start getting together. And the best way to do that, if the system is bad, all elected officials ain't looking out for us, the best way to do that is to focus at the local level and knock these guys out before they ever have a chance to move up any further.
Well, that's the thing, is that it's about getting people interested to do the work up front on those, on the congressional elections and the off years and the local elections and that kind of stuff. And then hopefully keeping this movement alive, unlike the Occupy movement. You don't want it to go away and be dead. You want it to keep up so it actually is worth something at the end. Because at the end, if in the next midterms or in the next presidential election, it ends up being the same thing, then it just goes back and it almost looks like it's just a bunch of whiny liberals who don't really do anything and they just went out. So you need to keep that progression going. But
so that's, you actually brought up a good point, right? So when you look at the Occupy movement, like, people had legit reasons to be out there, but there weren't any leaders, right? They specifically had this model where we're all the same, so we don't want a leader, but you need people like, you know, in the civil rights movement, like a Martin Luther King, you need these people out there that are talking truth to power that people are going to rally around and kind of guide the discussion. It would be really crazy, but if me learning how to rap and talk in front of people leads me to be the kind of person that's talking about this stuff and getting other people to like get on board, that's pretty dope. You know what I mean?
And I think that's one of the cool things that we keep learning about as we do this particular show is, you know, we talk to Ad too, and he's got his studio and he's teaching kids. And we have people like you out there that are well-versed in politics and being able to tell kids, listen, it doesn't matter who you listen to, your vote does count. You know, like I remember being a kid, whatever happened to this is a bill, this is only, or I am only a bill sitting here on Capitol Hill. You know what I mean? Whatever happened to all that?
Well, that's what I want to do. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, where you accidentally learn this stuff.
Well, so that's kind of what I want to do with Chicago Progress, is really working on creating content that is easy to digest and explains things very like succinctly. So like, I want to put together like 2-minute videos explaining what organizing means, or what is city council? What does an alderman do? What ward are you in? Like, these are fundamental things that people don't really think about or learn any other way.
Yeah, we got to talk.
What we saw, and honestly, like, the reason Bernie was so successful is because of social media, because corporate media for sure wasn't talking Bernie, right? They were
and Trump was too.
Yeah. So now
That matter, Barack was too.
Oh, they was huge with Barack.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So now, I mean, that's the way of doing things. The
power of being able to connect.
Yeah. With that being said,
but like that's it. It's like, now that we know. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No. Go ahead.
Finish it up.
So like, now that we see like the methods that we can communicate to each other, like, it's not the revolution won't be televised. It's like the revolution is going to be live streamed, right? The revolution is going to be shared on a timeline.
You're exactly right. Never in history have we been able to see people getting jacked up by cops live and on demand.
Yeah, and honestly, never. That's also. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, never in history were you able to see that. You know, people tell you a story. I was just standing here and a cop ran up and beat me down. People will be like, what did you do? Come on. Now people are streaming that. They're literally just sitting there and cops are literally running up on them and beating them down.
Yeah, no, and that's
now we can see. Your turn.
This is crazy. People of color ain't surprised by it. Right. Like,
right.
Everybody else watches like, oh, my God, this strange uptick in like police violence. And we're like, no, you just taped it. It's like, I mean, it's messed up. It's true. The other thing is social media also, if you look at it, really helped tear apart Hillary. Like, you can't do anything shady without us knowing what's going on the next day, because everyone's sharing it and there's a hashtag about it.
Right.
And we need to use that same tool, that same resource, responsibly, and use it to take out the people we need to take out. So if what we saw is on the Republican side, the Tea Party was like gangster, like they would show up and boo their own Republicans who weren't living their values and were able to kick people out and get their people in. We need to do that strategy with the Democratic Party so you don't get anybody who's like weak. You need people that have spines.
Right.
That are, this is what we stand for. We're down to fight. That if we don't do that to our own party, we're asking to get murdered and beat every time. Like, we're not winning. It's pretty crazy, but I think we've got the tools to do it if we're focused.
So you're trying to push to keep Nancy Pelosi in her position for a long time, right?
Yeah, or Rahm, right?
Yeah.
But you know what I mean? Like, so that's part of it is, like, how are you going to resist Trump if we can't resist Rahm?
Right.
Like, there's, like, I said this in speeches, like, it's literally like a video game. Like, Rahm's the level one boss, then you got Rauner at level two, and you got Trump, who's, like, the top boss of the whole game. That if you can't knock off these little bosses and exercise that power, you're just kind of yelling and not really focusing. But the truth of the matter is when you look at the local level, these dudes are super comfortable and super vulnerable. And if you just take all these, think about the 250,000 people that came out on their local leaders, what you would do to change the city. And being that it's such a huge city, what that would teach other cities and states about how to use that power. So I got shorties. I got a 2-year-old and a 3-year-old. And I know that when the second I had kids, you start thinking about your own mortality. I'm like, I'm going to be gone. And what do they end up with? So I'm committed to doing everything possible to doing some kind, especially with, yo, this guy is crazy, Trump. Like, look at what he doesn't even think about, like, the repercussions. This like, that's another thing that's crazy is, like, this Muslim ban. And then you see, like, within the same day, hundreds and thousands of people are coming out the airports. And, like, did wake up. And I hope that.
There's never been chaos like this.
Here's a headline that came over my phone. White House says President Trump fired acting Attorney General Sally Yates for refusing to enforce a legal order on immigration.
Yes.
He's literally sitting there saying, "You're fired, you're fired, you're fired."
The messed up thing though is that the Attorney General is there to preserve the laws of the Constitution and to push back on the president for doing things like that. It's not in his she's not there. The Attorney General is not there to impose his will. The Attorney General is there to enforce the laws and to be fair. So we're in uncharted waters. We could go on.
I'd be surprised if homeboy lasts the whole term, like straight up. I don't see it.
I don't really either.
Surprised.
Yeah.
But we could totally go to like other stuff. My bad.
No. I think it's time for this and that, right?
We gotta start another show, but
it is. So we'll just have a couple of opinions here for you. I think we each kinda have one. First, freestyle or written?
Is a great juice song. I would say everyone should know how to freestyle, but to be honest, like, look at the catalog of written songs that we have through all these like amazing hip hop artists. Like, I don't think it's even fair. Like, written all day. Like, think about like I Gave You Power by Nas. Like, think about like Pharoah Monch. Like,
what about for you though? What do you get off the most on? Off the top or writing a rhyme?
Writing. I think once I started really like working on crafting like songs, like I'm a lot more proud because you got something you can keep, right? Like,
sure.
This is like, I can play this for my kids. I mean, I guess I could play a freestyle for my kids, but it wouldn't be the same. So
I heard a couple of your freestyles. You bet.
Not around. But the other thing too is like, I can't even tell what year it happened, but eventually ciphers ended. Like, there aren't any ciphers. There's like the backpack ciphers or whatever, but there's not ciphers. Like, it just isn't there anymore.
Would you ever play Lamb Slaughter for your kids?
Yeah. I mean, when they're old enough, like, I'll play all that stuff. Like, my dad, I found out, used to be in like a band in Guatemala. I would have loved to have like heard what that was and like get a glimpse of that. So, yeah.
Cool. Brissy, you want to do the next one?
Yeah. Let's see. Oh, okay. So anybody that knows you knows that you have a couple of tattoos. Let me ask you, Big Pun or Stevie Wonder?
So, or Amy Winehouse. I got an Amy too.
Oh, you did? I haven't seen that one.
Oh, yeah. I got an Amy Winehouse.
I got a whole Amy Winehouse back piece.
Hey, she's a, like, let me tell you, she's a beast. I got to see her live. She's a monster. Like, she was mad wasted, and her voice was, like, perfect. I don't even, it was, like, crazy.
I never did see her live, but before you answer that, did you see her documentary that came out last year? Yeah. I thought that was an amazing documentary. It was an amazing story. She's an amazing talent and all that kind of stuff. I just love that it's a documentary of a person who's no longer with us, but told from 100% their voice. I loved how it was put together. It was just, if anybody hasn't seen it, check out the Amy Winehouse documentary.
It was amazing.
And what's sick about her is she's a hip hop head, right? So it's like, she's got a song on Back to Black that's dedicated to her, like, really loving Nas. And she's got a song on her first album that she's rhyming over, that she's singing over Major Look. So it's like, it's a hip hop head doing it. So when I saw her at the Vic Theater, so it wasn't even huge. It was like a small little spot seeing her that it was, so let's say out of the tattoos, come on, Stevie all day. Like, Big Pun's a beast. But we're talking Stevie Wonder. Like, Stevie Wonder is, like, up there. There's Michael Jackson, there's Stevie Wonder, there's Marvin Gaye, there's, like,
Otis
Redding. I love Pun. Rest in peace. But, I mean, Stevie all day. Yeah.
This is another one that's geared towards freestyle. The Point or Navy Pier?
Navy Pier. For me, Navy Pier. Like, that's – I'd gone to The Point a couple times, but my stomping grounds – were Navy Pier, like, hands down. Just
fair enough.
Something about having to walk from one end to the other and, like, this journey. It was like 300 before the movie. Like, wow, who am I battling next to get to, like, the other end? to me, that was it definitely.
All right, so I know we were talking about using the internet to get the word out and social media and all this good stuff. I want to know, eBay or Amazon Prime?
Amazon Prime? Are you kidding? Amazon Prime's so, like, it's whack, though, because we should be all against all the corporations, XYZ, all that good stuff. But the ability to just get anything you want delivered super quick is, I mean, come on.
And the name is pretty cool, too, huh?
can't hate on that. Like, I want, you know.
I mean, if we're going to go there, Optimus Prime or Megatron?
Optimus Prime all day.
If we're going to go there,
not the movies.
If we're going to go there, barbecue ribs or prime rib?
Barbecue ribs.
Okay, that's not like a comparison.
Oh, Barb's always there to keep us in check.
Hey, you know.
I never even came up with the name Prime, so I mean, now I ride with it. So that's good.
Yo, regular numbers or prime numbers?
We hit it. I missed that.
Fractions or prime numbers?
Or decimals?
Prime numbers?
No, I said regular numbers.
Prime numbers all day. Indivisible, son. Just by one.
Okay.
One, yeah.
All right, as the train starts to derail from the tracks here, want to give a couple quick shout outs. Jory from 606 has been tuning in, so what's up with Jory? And we got Brian from Dusty Groove watching, Pugs checking us out, Shazam Bangles always checking us out, and we got a special note here from a one Metamo to Prime.
Hands down, one of the most powerful voices in the city. Like, rhyme-wise, like,
yeah,
that voice is crazy.
Yeah. He says, the route that you took is just way cool. He's proud of you, and he bet that you can still whack some motherfucker on that cable.
Yeah. Now I'm all about, like, proper political debate.
So as we finish, man, if people want to get more involved or want to know more what you're doing, where can they find you at? Where can they check the stuff out at?
Yeah, so like I said, we've got chicagoprogress.com, which I'm actually thinking about doing some kind of fundraiser March 4th that might be, like, more hip-hop based to get more, like, the heads out. But if anyone wants to really organize or has ever thought of, like, running for office, like, reclaimchicago.org. that group right there is so strategic and so focused on really taking all that, that people power and building power and a base and going after like the local electeds that don't represent for us, that I would like legit guarantee, I would say go to do that. Every first Monday of the month, 7 to 9 p.m. at the Harlan Cafe, we meet up. Every second Saturday, so this Saturday coming up, February 4th, at Bud Longwood's Library, 5630 North Lincoln, we're doing a canvassing event so people can meet other people, knock on doors, and kind of get everyone organized. And then the last Thursday of every month, we have Drinks and Discourse. Honestly, that's probably the best one if you've never been involved with politics and you're kind of like nervous about it. Like, it's everyone hanging out at a bar, just getting drinks and just talking. So you can kind of go in and just start building with people and just see where that takes off. But awesome. ReclaimChicago.org, ChicagoProgress.com. Thank you very much.
Thank
you very much.
Barb.
Go through the whole that.
All right.
Barb,
okay.
People check out Midway's social media producer at.
Oh, I'm on Twitter at Babs76_, also on Facebook and on LinkedIn for all your social media tips and tricks. And Prime, you really should drop the mic before we leave tonight. You should be the one to go, boop.
Risky.
Best place is probably Instagram. DJ Risky Biz 1975, DJ RISKYBIZ 1975.
The Tom Cruise of this stuff. Word up. I always do that.
Do not make his head any bigger than it already is.
Nope.
Carlos just said what I was thinking. So
yo, I just want to do a shout out to Mike 1-2, because whenever I think Risky, like, yo, that legit was the crew back.
Oh, now we're going downhill. No.
We were starting to go downhill. Now we've really gone off the deep end.
Now we're there.
Did we bottom
now
out?
We're shouting out Mike 1. What?
You see Frost Tips holding it down.
Yeah. Oh.
I love that dude like a brother. Right up.
Carlos. Where can the folks find you?
You can go to carlosrgomez.com or just do a search for Coconut Justice. That's me everywhere.
And check out Sketch Zone podcast.
Yeah, so.
Don't forget about that.
That too.
And you can find me at 278 Media on Twitter and Instagram. The number is 278 Media. And of course, Midway, you can check out everything. MidwayDocumentary.com, MidwayDoc on Twitter and Instagram. YouTube.com/MidwayDocumentaryShy. Trust me, I try to get all the names the same, but some things are taken. So check us out there. And I want to say again, for anybody who's listening to this before tomorrow night, we got that event with the Chicago History Museum, and that starts at 6 o'clock at the Chicago History Museum. So check that out. We're going to take next week off. Hopefully we will be doing some live streaming of what we will be doing instead of Midway Radio. So check that out. We have something potentially cool lined up. And we'll be back a week after that. And that's it, folks.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Prime, dude, thanks a lot for coming, man. This is
No, man.
This is good. This is fun.
It's
insightful.
Really,
we drop knowledge.
Yeah, man. Now that straight up, like, thank you, because now that I'm a parent, I don't ever do anything in the evening, like, talk to other people, and so this is like,
like, older humans.
Yeah, like a baby. I got a baby ass curfew. Like, I'm ready to knock out. So.
Oh my god, it's 10 o'clock. I gotta be in bed soon.
Where's my warm milk? Yeah, it's like really wet.
Oh my god.
Rub my belly.
No battles and no bars going on there. Like, no.
All right, everybody. Until the next show, we will check it later.
Peace.
Peace.